Last time we showed wireless power transmission between two Tesla coils. But what about Tesla's other goal? Wireless communication. First, we need some kind of modulation scheme to encode data onto the carrier signal of the Tesla coil. To keep it simple, just go with on-off keying to encode binary data, zeros and ones.
To do that, I need a way to interrupt the Tesla coil based on the digital signal we want to communicate. We're using the 833A vacuum tube Tesla coil from before to do this, and the interrupting is done by adding this MOSFET in series with the circuit, between the cathode of the tube and ground. Now, we can modulate the coil based on a digital signal. I have to keep the input power from the variac turned way down though to avoid roasting this MOSFET. I already killed one of them doing this.
So what kind of information can we communicate? Well, back in Tesla's day, Morse code was a widely used form of communication. Okay, so that works, but now let's try something a bit more modern. And by modern, I mean the 1980s.
So here's the idea. Can I connect the serial ports on a couple of Raspberry Pis to my pair of Tesla coils and transmit serial data from one Raspberry Pi to the other? Pretty much every kind of digital communication these days is some form of serial communication, but the old school serial UART protocol that has been around since the earliest days of computers is something pretty straightforward that we can try.
Now, there's no way in hell I'm connecting these Raspberry Pis directly to these Tesla coils. Low voltage sensitive electronics do not play nice with high voltage. I need a way to electrically isolate the Pis from these Tesla coils.
To do that, I'm going to use fiber optics to connect the Raspberry Pis to the Tesla coils. This lets me keep the Pis relatively far away from the Tesla coils, and there's no direct electrical connection between them. The TX pin on the Pi that's the sender controls the first optical transmitter. The receiver circuit on the other end of that fiber optic line then triggers the MOSFET to interrupt the Tesla coil. When the fiber optic LED is on, the Tesla coil is on. Then, the other Tesla coil receives some of that power through resonant coupling. That then gets stepped back down to low voltage, rectified, and then sent through a low-pass filter to remove the roughly 200 kHz resonant frequency oscillations of the Tesla coil, and then that signal is used to trigger another optical transmitter. And finally, that optical receiver is connected to the RX pin of the Raspberry Pi that's the receiver.
One other thing we gotta deal with. Currently the Tesla coil is powered with AC input from a microwave oven transformer. It's level shifted with a diode and a capacitor so that it's 0 to whatever 1000 volts depending on what I have the variac set to, but it's still an AC signal. What this means is the 60 Hz line frequency is going to be superimposed onto the Tesla coil signal.
You can actually see the 60 Hz line frequency on the scope on the detector circuit on the receiver Tesla coil side. This is going to get confused with the serial data we want to send, so we need a way to remove this. And we can do that by providing the transmitting Tesla coil with smooth DC input power instead of level shifted AC. This actually has a pretty dramatic effect on the Tesla coil arc too. It's a lot smaller and more just like corona discharge from a flyback transformer. First time I've made a DC vacuum tube Tesla coil.
Also, in order to get smooth DC, I needed a big smoothing capacitor. Adding that to the circuit made this significantly more dangerous, however. It even says right here on the capacitor, the energy stored in this capacitor is lethal. So on today's how much will this kill you meter, this gets a 5 out of 5. I'm not kidding, this has been sitting here for about 2 minutes now, and this is how much energy is still in that capacitor. In the words of photonic induction, if you touch this, you will be dead before you hit the floor. Don't f*** with big capacitors. I need to put a bleeder resistor on this so that it discharges slowly while it's turned off. Absolutely do not try this yourself. Anyway, back to serial communication. Now there's one more thing we need to consider, which is the baud rate, or data rate, of the serial port. Tesla coils look pretty instantaneous to the human eye, but on the scale of microseconds, there actually is a pretty non-negligible turn-on and turn-off transient time. This is because a Tesla coil is a loosely coupled resonant transformer. It takes some time for energy to build up in the secondary LC circuit to build up high enough voltages where it starts breaking out, like we're used to seeing. And similarly, when it turns off, there's energy stored in both the secondary and primary LC circuits that take some time to dissipate. So, the max baud rate we can use is going to be limited by the transient time of the Tesla coil. I could probably figure out what this is theoretically, but you're sick of listening to me talk, and I don't feel like doing it, so let's just try it.
Okay, what's your default baud rate? Okay, that's probably way too fast, but we'll see what happens. Nope, nothing. Okay, what about 4800? Nope, nothing. All right, what about 2400? Nothing. Alright, what about 1200? Nothing. Oh man, this is getting really slow now. Alright, take it down to 600. The hardware, the Raspberry Pi, can't go any slower than 1200. Damn it. Is this not gonna work? Actually.
So there's this thing called software UART, where a serial port can be implemented on a normal general purpose input output or GPIO pin, and everything is handled in software using the CPU clock instead of a hardware UART. This is typically unreliable at high data rates because operating system time can't be guaranteed to be consistent on a non-real-time operating system, and you might lose some bits. Shouldn't matter to us though, we actually want it to go really slow.
Okay, come on, 600. Nothing. Damn it. Alright, fine. 300. There we go. Hey, look at that. Yeah. This actually works. Damn. Why? This is stupid. Why does that work? Wait. This is stupid. Nope. How's it doesn't work? Oh, oh, there we go. We got a bunch of them queued up in the buffer. So then we got the stop bit. Oh wait, I have an idea.
Hello, I'm a Tesla coil. Is this how I make big YouTube cash money? Hot damn, this actually works. Sometimes, it's really unreliable. What are you doing, Dave? I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
So we did it. We were able to communicate information wirelessly between two Tesla coils. Was it worth the effort? Absolutely not. You have a far more effective, cheaper, smaller, lower power, just better way of doing this, and you carry it around with you in your pocket every day. It's called your cell phone. Radio communication is just by far a superior way of doing this. There probably is some little bit amount of radio energy being exchanged between the Tesla coils, but Tesla coils like this are not very efficient radio transmitters, and the magnitude of energy coming from that is so small compared to the resonant capacitive coupling and resonant inductive coupling between the two coils. So, is this an effective way to communicate information wirelessly? Absolutely not. Is it an effective way to waste a lot of time and do something absolutely pointless? Yes. Tune in next time for full IEEE 802.11s mesh networking, but with Tesla coils.
Subscribe to Coil Labs for more.